últimamente es hacer un par de demos de Foreman. No sé si alguno lo habéis usado. Es un proyecto open source de... Lo definimos como lifecycle management del sistema, o sea, manejamos desde que decides tener una máquina virtual o física o contenedores ahora mismo, hasta que decides deshacerte de ella y puedes configurarla, puedes provisionarla por Pixie, provisionarla con, pues con cualquier recurso que uses, como yo que sé, DigitalOcean o AWS o OpenStack, lo que sea. Entonces, voy a explicar un poco con un par de transparencias qué es en plan súper rápido y luego voy a poner...
Igual las tienes que mover ahí las
otras. Sí. Si no...
Te muevo yo también.
La idea principal es hacer un poco de demo de un caso de uso un poco real. No sé si alguno trabajáis con máquinas físicas aquí, en plan conectarlas en el centro de datos, provisionarlas. Sí. Bueno, pues voy a intentar cubrir un poco ese caso. Si consigo pasar el ratón a esta pantalla. Ahí. Bueno. Vale. Bueno, lo que quería decir con eso de lifecycle es eso, desde que necesitas la máquina, la provisionamos con un montón de sistemas, con Pixie, con una imagen de disco si quieres también, lo que estaba diciendo antes, recursos en la nube, como Amazon OpenStack o lo que sea. Y nada, una vez la máquina está configurada, se registra en Foreman. Ahora veremos lo que es, porque es un poco, si no lo he visto nunca, es un poco difícil de imaginar, imagino. Luego la podemos configurar con Puppet o Sol, o... Sí, ahora son los dos únicos que soportamos, pero tenemos un API que estamos intentando hacer otros... Estamos intentando soportar otros sistemas de configuración. Y una vez la máquina ya está corriendo, pues hay que configurarla, perdón, está configurada, pues nos ocupamos de manejar el actualizar los paquetes, si tienes errata en CentOS o si tienes errata en REL, aplicarla para si hay algún problema de seguridad o algo por el estilo, pues actualizar la máquina virtual o física. bueno, eso es lo que... Intentar explicar un poco antes. Configuración. Aquí no sé si todos usáis Puppet o. Porque lo que he visto antes ha explicado un poco Puppet. ¿Todos lo conocéis?
Sí.
O sea, lo, en plan, ¿habéis hecho algo con él? Vale. Pues ahora veremos cómo con Foreman puedes como cambiar un poco los. Los parámetros de Puppet para ciertas máquinas o ciertos grupos de máquinas, por ejemplo, decir, pues este es el grupo del cluster de bases de datos de MySQL para mi blog. Pues va a tener unos parámetros diferentes que mi base de datos de MySQL para, yo qué sé, para procesar los vídeos que salgan en esta charla, o inventarme alguna tontería. Con lo de monitoring, lo que quiero decir es procesamos los reports cuando tú coges Puppet o Chef o Sol, que son los reports que soporta ahora mismo, se manda un informe de que ha ido bien, que ha ido mal, que se ha roto, que no se ha roto, y esto llega a tu máquina, a Foreman, y te enseña por cada máquina que todo está pasando bien, que todo está pasando mal, te manda un email si algo se ha roto. Y ahora aceptamos también reportes de OpenSCAP, que seguro yo creo que no lo ha visto a ninguno, porque yo no lo había visto nunca, pero es un sistema para asegurarse que los paquetes que hay en tu ordenador estén al día y básicamente tú le defines como una especie como de política de seguridad y OpenStack como que se dedica a verificar que eso se cumple. Y pues en sitios como yo que sé, en el gobierno de Estados Unidos, sobre todo sitios públicos, pues te obligan un poco a que puedas verificar que los paquetes que hay en una máquina estén al día. Ahora lo vemos porque ya digo, a mí las transparencias me parece seguro que aburrido si no lo has visto y como poco no, si no lo has visto nunca no lo voy a entender así de primera, así que por eso quiero pasar la demo lo más rápido posible. ¿Cómo funciona esto? Es básicamente con una aplicación web central que es Foreman. Esto sería como cualquier tipo de máquina en la nube, pues mandarían sus reports de vuelta a Foreman de cualquier sistema que corra. Y para ser capaz de funcionar en varias redes, por ejemplo, si dentro de tu centro de datos tienes pues dos redes segmentadas, pues puedes poner un proxy en una que se ocupe del DNS, de HTTP y todo eso en una de las redes y otro en otra. Entonces, eso te permite que sin tener contacto directo a un punto que puede no ser seguro, como puede ser Foreman en este caso, solo teniendo un proxy en cada red, pues puedes provisionar. Ah, bueno, si te vais máquinas físicas también te permite acceder a interfaces DMC, o sea que puedes hacer operaciones de encender, apagar, tal, directamente a la tarjeta de red para máquinas físicas. No sé si se puede virtualizar eso, creo que no. Bueno, tampoco hace falta mucho contar la historia, pero empezó un proyecto open source hace 6 años. El que es ahora mi manager le gustó la red del proyecto y decidió sponsorizarlo. Yo estaba un pelín antes de que empezara con Red Hat y una vez, bueno, empezó al sponsorizar el proyecto, pues contrató a gente del equipo de core y tiene una comunidad bastante grande, hay como, no sé, unas 300 personas en IRC todos los días. Una lista de correo bastante activa y hacemos un evento relativamente grande al año en Config Management Camp en Dante, en Bélgica, en el cual pues nos juntamos con el resto de la comunidad y tenemos una sala en la conferencia para nosotros. Y nada, esos son un poco sitios que lo usan, o sea, funciona en producción. Yo antes estaba en el CERN y funcionaba muy bien. De hecho, una vez me cargué el directorio de Jan Ripo haciendo tonterías con Puppet y gracias a esto, pues, gracias a cambiar un par de planos y conformarlo, conseguimos arreglar. Si te cargas el directorio de Jan Ripo en CentOS, bueno, era Scientific Linux, que es derivado, pues no tienes actualizaciones de paquetes, con lo cual es un problema serio. Nada, esto no es importante. Se instala con un instalador que está basado en Puppet. Los módulos que usamos son públicos, están en GitHub y simplemente te hacen unas preguntas en plan, ¿necesitas un proxy en esta red? ¿No lo necesitas? ¿Quieres que te manejemos el DNS? ¿Prefieres que no? Bueno, realmente no lo manejamos. Realmente lo que hace Foreman es se conecta a los servicios que haya. Pues si hay un DHCP de Libbuild, pues se conecta ahí. Si hay un DHCP de IST, por ejemplo, pues se conecta ahí. Y lo mismo con DNS y con TCP. Nada, tiene un API muy chula. Luego vamos a ver si queréis. Y un CLI que se llama Hammer. Puedo hacer la bromita porque Foreman en inglés es el jefe de obra. Así que vamos allá. Bueno, a ver. Vale. Hostia, no se ve ninguna línea con este contraste. Bueno, cuando tú entras en Foreman así de primeras, es una tabla realmente. No sé muy bien. Bueno, cuando tú entras en Foreman así de primeras, lo que te encuentras es un dashboard. Yo sí debería estar conectado a internet, ¿no?
Tienes algún problema, ¿eh?
¿Cómo?
Que igual tienes algún problema, lo digo porque a
¿Sí?
mí me ha fallado la demo por eso.
Es que estando sentado ahí estaba conectado seguro. Un segundo que me desconecto y me reconecto. Bueno, según entras, lo que te sale es un dashboard con las máquinas que tienes, si hay algún problema, qué máquinas están bien. Aquí, vale, sí, ya funciona. ¿Tienes? We can increase the contrast of the projector.
I'm not
Detrás,
sure, you might have to read my control, but I'm.
detrás, detrás, detrás.
The
Otra
other
mano.
one.
De tuyo, tuyo, detrás tuyo.
Ah.
No,
No,
abajo,
no, no,
abajo
just
en el kit de la
Ah,
mano.
my
Vale.
control.
Lo voy a intentar un momento y si no se puede, pues. Bueno, más o menos se intuye.
Pues
Sí,
me.
no veo aquí nada de eso. Ah, no sé, sí, no tengo idea. Bueno, según entras, pues tienes aquí un dashboard que te muestra qué máquinas están activas. Pues este es un poco mi laboratorio, como dice casero. Entonces, la mayoría están muertas. Solo hay. A ver. Hola. Hi. Do you speak Spanish, English?
Spanish.
Okay, so I was given to talk in Spanish.
Now you have to
No,
switch to English.
I'll switch to English. Yeah. So when you come, so when you open Foreman for the first time, you get a dashboard with a list of hosts, and you see this host configuration status applet basically shows you what hosts have failed their public runs or which hosts have been successful and so forth. So here we can see that, okay, I'll try to zoom in. We can see that we have 11 hosts that have never reported to Puppet. This is probably because I have a lot of CoreOS hosts in this Foreman deployment, and you can't, or atomic hosts here actually, and you can't run Puppet on atomic or CoreOS. That is just like a donut graph of the status of your I was going to say data center, but it doesn't have to be that. It can be anything. Of the hosts that you have in Foreman. So out of sync means that at some point they have reported, but right now they're done and they're either dead or they're probably like liver machines that I have not turned up, turned on. You can also see things here like latest events. What these events are is basically every time that you run that. Well, in this case, it's public because I configure all my stuff with public. But every time you run Puppet or it runs automatically on the machine, you get a report back. And in this case, it's apparently applying something every 30 minutes, which is the fault interval in Puppet. So we can see that it's changing the message of the day. And that's probably because the message of the day that I have here changes. It displays the available memory. We can see a more interesting report here with 20 things that it applied and some errors. Okay, so yeah. So for things that it applies, it's not very interesting, but if you spot failures here, like, oh, this one is interesting, actually. In this one, we were trying to apply the WordPress class to install WordPress in a machine, but it didn't work because we didn't include the right MySQL class, so it failed, and it allowed me to see this without having to SSH into the host and so forth. This is not only good if you don't have SSH access to your hosts, But also, even if you do, you can get like warnings, and you can configure email notifications and stuff like that here. You can see the run distribution here. I obviously don't have a lot of hosts here, but if you had, you would see a lot more bars. This means that that a few minutes ago, some host have run, and these tasks they basically have to do with other things that have happened in Foreman. Like you can also run remote execution commands on your machines. So these are basically what these are basically the output of those. What I'm going to do now is try to imagine of the situation where you just bought Rack in your data center and you want to connect it and you want it to be what I said before, a WordPress blog VM or something like that, and you didn't really know what to do with it. Well, right now, if you don't have any automation, what you do is you connect it, you find a way to turn it on either with like serial over LAN or something like that, or something like that. You connect to the machine and configure it somehow, and after some time, you have like a working machine. What we're going to do instead is to boot a VM through libvirt, which is going to simply boot. It's not going to boot with any image or anything like that. It's just going to boot in a network that has a Pixie server installed. So that would be the case for any hardware that you connect in the data center, I would say. So you click here and network boot. This is just like a simulation, but as I'm saying, it would be and it will be physically connected, turning on in a physical setup. So just 1 gig of RAM and 20 gigs of disk. Let's call this Barcelona, and I'm going to configure this a bit so we can see the output as soon as it's loaded. So first off, we want the boot to include NIC, so that it loads the it starts from Pixie, and we also want VNC on all the interfaces so we can see what's going on from the outside from the very beginning. So I thought about doing this whole thing live, but it's going to take a while to do the whole thing, to do the whole dance from this to actual WordPress blog. Well, so this is what would happen if you connect, if you have connected something. It would boot and fetch the micro image from Pixie. It would load this, and this is, I'm not going to touch it, it's just going to time out, and it's going to default to discovery. What this is doing is to download, to gather some facts about this machine, and after some, how do you call it, like a report with facts about the machine to Foreman. Okay, I guess you can't see it. I don't know if I can zoom in here. So if you see it here, it gathered a few facts, like the IP address and stuff like that, and it sent all of these to this address, and Foreman replied with 200. So what does this mean? By the way, if you think the interface is a little complicated, that's because I have a million plugins installed. Usually, that's not the case. It's just because I'm working on this. So I want to know everything that's going on. So now we see it here in the discovered hosts page. But by the way, you can interrupt me if you want, or if you have any questions. You could do this without touching anything. Like what I'm going to do here is to provision and choose the OS, and that's good. That's going to be the whole thing. But if you define some rules here, you can say all the machines that were created after today. Yeah, sorry. So all the ends that, or all machines that were discovered after today, they're going to be part of a core OS cluster, which is this host group thing is basically a definition for, like, I wouldn't call it a template. Yeah, like a blueprint of how your host should look like. So it contains things like the definition of the network, the definition of the operating system, and stuff like that. Where you can, if you're not, you don't like matching by date, you can match by a bunch of things here, like format of the Mac, how much memory a machine has, the subnet, which is very useful, like machines in a certain subnet, you might want to provision them automatically with something. Right? But I didn't create one because I wanted to show you the whole process. But if you create one, you don't even see the VM here. It automatically provisions. So I click on provision here. And it will give us a lot of options, actually, right now, of how to configure the machine. Since I already have something here, which is called the host group provision from here, this already contains a definition for the operating system, a definition for the, oh, I thought it contained a definition for the puppet master and puppet chief. Okay, well, it contains a definition for the OS and the interface. So if I come here, I see that it chose CentOS 7.1, so it's going to provision CentOS 7.1. It's going to provision it from a CentOS mirror, which is just telling it to use the official CentOS repository, and it's going to provision it with a Kickstarter that I already defined. You can customize all of this. You can customize all of this, and if you want to provide different templates. If you are provisioning a VM, for instance, you might not want an actual Kickstarter. You might want user data or something like that. You can also do that. I'm going to define the root password, and I see that it's going to pick up the Kickstarter template that it said before. All these other templates would also work, but in different situations, like user data would work, what I said before, if it would be a VM, and Pixie if I rebooted the machine again, and so forth. So aside from the OS, it already configured my interface with a MAC address that I saw before. We can change this to Barcelona again. We have here, if we want a different one, we can just click here and it will prompt the DHCP proxy, and it will check if there's a free IP lease, a free DHCP lease in the network. I don't know why that happens. So it got a different IP. You can leave the one by default, but I just wanted to show you that. And if you want to add some classes, I have a few classes here. These all come from the Foreman proxy, where I'm running a puppet master. So from there, I have a group of classes, which is called a config group, that is just standard build that contains. I don't need a raspberry right now.
Yeah, that sounds like an invitation for the coffee break, but
So when you click on the config group, it includes like a set of classes, and in here it's the message of the day, Vim and NTP, but you can include whatever you want. If you want to install a PuppetDB server, you just include here PuppetDB. If you want to include a Postgres client, you can here click on Postgres client. It's very simple. After you're done with all these options, you click on submit. Usually you don't spend a lot of time like now. And it started. If we come back to the VM, it probably is rebooting right now. Or okay, yeah, it just rebooted, and it's going to try to provision from the CentOS mirror right now. Well, you can see it there that it's that it now loaded the CentOS image. That we wait like 30 seconds, it will start to load Anaconda. I can show you that in a minute. I'm not sure what that is. Probably, I don't even know what that is at all. I'm thinking that it might be a new plugin that I installed today. But anyway, so just so I can show you how this looks after it's provisioned, because I think nobody here wants to wait until Anaconda finishes to install CentOS. It will take maybe 20, 30 minutes at least. We can see, let me zoom in because I don't see it myself. As you can see, I have like a very diverse set of hosts in here. They have like very different OSs, and it works with pretty much in that. Okay, so this one I created this one a few hours ago. So when you click on it, we'll see a graph of the changes that have happened to the host in Puppet. I'm not sure why it's so slow right now. Yeah, so this basically shows the how long did it take to run Puppet in that host. So we can see that the initial run took a long time, and the ones after that didn't take so long because it's they included like minor changes. Similarly, we can see here that on first Puppet run we applied a bunch of stuff. Subsequent ones we don't. We can see this here, which is basically changing the message of the day as I had showed you before. And we can see some more information here about the host, like the information that we saw before, some metrics about what's failing to apply in the host, and what templates would apply to it if we try to do it again, and some information coming from Lippert, like what disk is it using, what pool is it using, is it on, and so forth. We can do things from Tempest 2. Oh, well, that's because it's on UTC, so it's 2 hours before now. What else? Am I running too late, or?
Well, it's actually the coffee break, so it depends if people want to go to have coffee.
Okay. I can show you like the remote execution plugin if you want. It's a demo. Sorry, yeah, it's still in beta. It's 0.0.10, and with all this lifecycle management tool that I showed you, on top of that, you can run remote execution queries on any host and so forth. But yeah, if it's the coffee break, it's, yeah.
Does it use any other provisioning tool other than Puppet?
Yeah, if you have Salt, there's a plugin called Foreman Salt that allows you to do the same thing. I didn't go into showing you parameters, but you can override parameters in a very smart way. So if you want to, let's say, let me actually find an example. This is admin password for over. So if you want to override this on a certain case where you have a different OS or a different subnet or anything like that, you can override that there. I didn't go into that before. Anyway, you can install the Foreman Soul plugin. There's a whole manual that explains how it works, but it allows you to apply pillars and run high state, which is the equivalent to puppet kick, so remote Soul run. I think it has a few screenshots here. Yeah, so it's very similar to in terms of features to the public provider. It also auto signs the CA equivalent insult for new hosts and so forth. And you can also see like the values that come from the Soul reports. And there's a Foreman Chef plugin as well. The problem with Foreman Chef though is that it doesn't support configuration yet. It only supports receiving reports. So it's a little limited in that regard. I can keep on showing you things forever if you guys want, but if you prefer to have coffee, that's fine. Okay.
Thanks a lot.